Welcome to Ask GMBN Tech. This is our weekly show where we get to answer your mountain bike tech related questions. You can send your questions in the comments below or the email address on the bottom of the screen right there. And kicking off this week, the first question is from Henrik L. Doddy, do muck-off products ever run out of date? Do you know what? I had to go and look at some to see if there was a sell-by date on, so I wasn't actually sure about this myself. But being chemical products, I'm sure at some point they would. So I actually had to ask muck-off, and this is what they said. They don't have use-by dates, but we do recommend keeping in a cool, dry place when you store them. Also, our athlete performance lines have to be used within 12 months of opening. So there you go. There's no real sell-by date. It's all about how you store that stuff. But I guess you're going to use this stuff fairly quickly, so I wouldn't worry about that too much. But just take note of the athlete performance lines, which do have a 12-month sell-by date on them. Next up is from Tom Roteman. Hi Doddy, I recently purchased a 1993 GT Team Avalanche from another local rider. I'm thinking of converting the original triple chainring and 7-speed cassette out. The worker might be a bit worn, understandably, from 1993. I want to swap it out to a more modern 1x SRAM setup. What parts and tools are required to get this done? Also, will there be a limit on how many gears I can run? Loving the show, cheers. PS, looking forward to seeing my bike on Rewind. I'm looking forward to seeing your bike on Rewind too. I'll keep an eye out for it, Tom. Okay, so firstly, very cool you've got that nice retro bike, and even cooler that you want to keep it running by slightly modernising it. So of course you could just go out and buy a whole SRAM 1x transmission, 1x11, 1x12, and bung it on there, no problem. But I'm guessing you want to save yourself a bit of money. So with your triple chain set, in 1993, I don't know if you were still on the bigger bolt circle diameter or you're on the smaller one, you'll have to check that. So there's various different chain rings available and they'll have a slightly different bolt circle diameter to them. So you'll need to know what that is in order to order the correct chain ring. Now, narrow wire technology is fairly new in respect of mountain bike technology, so you're not going to be able to get them to fit all bolt circle diameters for older cranks. So if that's the case and you can't find the right chainring, you might need to upgrade to a new crank set with a relevant chainring on there, in which case you'll need to replace a bottom bracket as well. So just based on the fact that you're going to change all that stuff, what you're going to need, here's a list of the things. So a bottom bracket tool, an 8mm Allen key, that's for putting the new cranks on, cable cutters, basic selection of Allen keys, a cassette tool for taking the old cassette off and of course putting the new one on, a vise to actually hold the cassette tool in or an adjustable spanner, and then a chain whip to hold the cassette still basically when you undo the old one. And of course, if you're going to be taking off the old cranks, then you may well need an old style Shimano bottom bracket tool and also an old style crank puller. However, if that's something you don't want to do yourself, you could just go to the bike shop and get that bit done, and then you wouldn't need to buy or use the old tool again, and you could just get the newer tools, which is going to be a bit more future-proof. Tools obviously are expensive, but I do recommend that every mountain biker has a good basic toolkit. It's well worth having, and have a look at the park website. They do a really good beginner's home toolkit. In fact, I gave away some souped up, like my sort of choice versions of that toolkit fairly recently on the channel. And I do recommend that's the sort of stuff that everyone should sort of aspire to get to. You don't necessarily need to have the top of the range tools, but the style of tools in there is what I'm talking about. Hopefully you can get on with that, because it's a fun job to turn a bike into a 1x transmission. It's also something I'm going to be doing in a maintenance video soon. I'm actually going to try and get a hold of some older bikes and start working on those bikes to try and reflect what you guys are actually all asking for. Next up is from Kevin Conahan. Doddy, I've had a creaky headset for some time, and I think it's due to the top cup moving in the frame. I've reinstalled it a couple of times with grease, then I've tried Threadlock, then Loctite Push Fit Assembly Compound 641, but it still creaks over bumps and hard braking. Is it possible to shim out the frame to get a better fit? P.S. It's a Hope headset and a tighter frame. Bottom cup goes in tight, but I can pull the top cup out with my fingers. Kevin, I've not heard of an undamaged frame with those sort of issues. Generally, if a headset doesn't, you know, if it fits in quite loose, it suggests to me the frame might be slightly stretched. And what happens is the frame could be ovalized or belled out slightly. There's a few reasons this can happen. It could happen for a manufacturing reason, but more than likely it's happened from an impact, in which case the frame, literally the metal is softer than the cups of the headset that are pushed into it, and it can just stretch even fractionally is enough to make it loose in there. And of course the other one is if it's been ridden with a loose headset in the first place. Think how long a fork is, all that leverage going through a tiny little head tube with a couple of bearings on. If one of those is loose and it's unable to play around at all, you're actually going to stretch the head tube of the bike. And I really hope for your sake you haven't done that to your frame, because if that's the case, you will be looking at a new frame down the line. So what I would suggest is take that headset out and see if you've got a friend with a similar cup they can take out of their bike, just so you can try it. Process of elimination. If their headset does fit your bike but it's still loose in there, then your frame is knackered, I'm afraid, and you're going to need to consider other options. You say it's the tightest frame, but you haven't said what it's made of. If it's made of steel, you can get that fixed. If it's aluminium, sometimes you can get the head tube taken off and have another one welded back on and get it reheat treated, but it could be an expensive process. So I hope for your sake it's just a dodgy headset and it's not the frame. But process of elimination, my friends, you're going to have to try and figure that one out. Next up is from Daniel Silver. Doddy, I'm doing a bike packing trip next month and I need to install a bag in the stem bar area to carry my stuff, but the cable of the fork lockout system's in the way. I'm just wondering, is it possible to easily change from a remote lockout to a crown lockout, or am I better off just taking the locking cable off and riding with the fork fully open? Depends what you want. Of course, there's a lot of cables on the bar, so you can reduce that by getting a conversion kit from whoever your suspension fork is by, whether it's Fox or RockShox. Now, it will cost you to get those parts, but it is worth doing. It does mean your fork's got the same adjustment but built onto it rather than at the bars. Now, you're going to need to look this up yourself because you haven't actually told me which it is. So I did ask Fox UK about this because I have a Fox fork on my bike with an adjustable lockout from the bars. Now, I can get the internal bits for that particular fork and it's not that expensive to do that process. And you can do this the other way around as well if you wanted to have lockout at the bars, but it might be more expensive depending on what your particular fork is. I mean, you say the other option is you could just take it off for that trip and run the fork fully open. I don't see a problem with that. You're gonna have to probably run slightly more air pressure in your fork anyway to compensate for the weight of stuff, so you might get away with that. I would definitely try that first. It's probably a cheaper option, and it does mean after your bike packing trip you can put the cable back on again and make most of that handlebar lockout. However, if the handlebar lockout is not something you like to use that much, then I would do the upgrade and go for the fork look. Nice and clean, it's all there, the same adjustment, you don't lose any performance from your fork, and more importantly, the cable is not in your way. Good luck with that. Next up is from Mikey Ponsford. Doddy, loving the show. I've got a Scott Genius LT 700 tuned 2016 model, and as you probably know, it came with a front hub, Synchros TR15 plus CL Boost, made by DT Swiss, and a rear hub as well. What I'd like to ask you is, can you please do a show showing how to service the bearings on both front and rear hubs? I can do most things when it comes to bikes, but I don't know everything, and these three axles are very new to me. The reason why I'm asking is because I asked my local bike shop how much a full service would cost, and to do the whole bike, including forks and shock, it cost me £450. Thanks for your help. Anything you can give me would be appreciated. Yeah, actually a few people have asked about hub bearing overhaul, so we are going to do that. I'm going to try and do it with a couple of different wheels. We tend to have DT wheels on most of our bikes here, so very similar to your particular wheels. But to remove the bearings on the inside of DT wheels, you need a special tool, and that is a dedicated tool from DT. So I've ordered one of those, and as soon as it comes in, I'll show you how to whip those bearings out and put the new ones back in. However, you might decide that it's not worth your while getting that tool for yourself. Like some hubs, you can, with a punch, take the bearings straight out, but with the DT ones, you certainly have to have that specific tool. And when we're doing a video like a hub overhaul, we can only be quite general with it, because it's impossible to actually make a video like that for every single hub, but we'll be there all year just making those videos. So I'll try and be as general as I can. I'll try and include any recommendations for specific hubs that do have unique tooling for them, because we do know of quite a few out there, but we'll try and help you as best as we can. But that will be coming quite soon on GMBN Tech. In the meantime, good luck with your bike and keep an eye out for that video. Next up is from Super Specky Four Eyes. I was just wondering if riding drop-offs whilst the fork locked out is bad for your forks or shock. I can't be the only one who's forgotten to set them open after a long climb. Cheers. No, generally speaking, when you have a fork or a shock and lockout, it has a blow-off feature. If it was just to stay locked out, then it will damage the internals of that. And I have heard about it before in the past, especially with shocks where people have been riding with them locked out too often. And you can actually like bend the shims on the inside. It's no biggie because you can replace that stuff, but it is at your expense because you're going to have to pay for get your shock taken apart and rebuilt with those new parts inside. Now, I wouldn't worry about it too much. You're quite happy to like run them locked out and do the odd jump here and there. Just don't make too much of a habit of it. The blow-off feature is there for a reason. It allows the oil to like blow straight past there, so your fork will actuate and it won't damage. But just don't worry about it, but just try and pay a bit more attention and it should be all right. All right, this one's from Dan San. Doddy, I'm sure you'll know the difference between the 11-speed SRAM cassette, 1195 and 1199. They're close in price and weight. They talk about coating, thanks. So with the coating, there's the silver edition and there's a black one. I think they're called a coating jet on that. Basically it's like an anti-corrosion, or at least a corrosion resistant coating that's supposed to make the cassette last a bit longer. It's not going to last any longer to physical wear because it's essentially the same thing, but it's that resistance against corrosion, and it definitely does do that, so technically your cassette will last a bit longer. However, because it's got that black coating on it, you do notice it when it starts wearing more than you would on a silver cassette, and for that reason some people prefer to stick to the silver cassettes. I don't worry about that sort of thing too much. I like the fact it's a bit more corrosion resistant, and I don't mind it when it looks a bit worn. I'm like, that's cool, it's like a bit of patina. I'd go for the black one myself. I don't think there's any strict advantage to either of them. Perhaps if you're riding in dry conditions more often, you don't need to go for that corrosion one. If you're riding in wet conditions, might be a better idea. But I'd go for the black one all day long. I think that looks cool. And the last one this week is in relation to rear shocks. This is from Andy J. Loving the channel, it's been really helpful for me so far. Thank you for that, Andy. I'm curious about the positioning of rear shocks. Does the positioning and fixing point of the rear shock affect ride handling? E.g., a rear shock that's vertical compared to one that's angled, as well as being fixed to the top tube or the down tube like the Yeti ASR5 or the White T130 compared to Canyon Neuron. Thanks. This is a bit of a tricky one because there's a lot of different things I could talk about here. If you're just literally talking about the physicality of where the shock is, the shock will be functioning exactly the same as any other shock, but of course they're going to perform differently because it's down to the characteristics of that suspension system. Now ideally, a shock, you want it as low on the bike as possible just for weight distribution, and all of those heavier components in a rear suspension design like the big aluminium rockers and stuff, if you can keep that nice and low, look at the Santa Cruz Nomad for example, everything's quite low down on that bike, gives you a good center of gravity down there, tucks everything away. But of course it's not the same with all bikes. Some bikes are cleaner lines, like that new Canyon Lux, the top tube mounted shock there goes right in line with that top tube, super clean looking. The actual physicality of the shock working is gonna be no different, but they will feel completely different just because of the suspension design. Now we're gonna be doing a bit of a suspension 101 feature soon, because a lot of people have been asking for this video, but we are actually getting some motion graphics made for this, so you can actually understand a bit what's going on. So just be patient and we'll explain things in a bit more detail. There you go, so there's another weekly Ask GMBN Tech in the bag. For a couple more great videos, click up here and down there. And of course, if you've got any questions, fire them in. We love answering your questions. Get them into the email address. It was on the screen at the beginning of the show. And of course, in the comments below this, use that hashtag AskGMBNTech, just so we know which ones are questions and which ones are actually comments on this show. Love having you guys interact with us. We love having you here. Of course, please subscribe to the channel by clicking on that globe. Tell everyone about us. And if you like asking questions about mountain bikes, give us a thumbs up.